Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wachama Talks. This is episode 13, and within episode 13, this is episode 2 of Wachama on tour, because we are in Groningen now. And yeah, we are the guests, but our guest on the show is Erik Schoppen. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
Erik was born in Sneek, which is a Friese town.
Friesian town, yeah.
Friesian town.
Yeah.
And then he grew up in a little tiny village, which is like, has only 600 or 700 people live there.
Yeah. It's called Ijsbrechten.
Ijsbrechten. He was 13 when he found some packages on the road and have seen these brands, and he got fascinated. And as a kid who grew up in a village, he was already fascinated by nature and people and how nature works. But when he has seen these strange brands and shapes of bottles and packaging on the side of the road, then he got fascinated. Then he started to study more about design and brands. And first he became a designer, right?
Yes. Yeah.
After he went more into, because that was the late 90s when the internet came in, and then he went more into the new media, and also the interface design, that kind of things. And when Apple came in, I'm just highlighting the shorts. When Apple came in and became a big brand, or it seemed to be, oh, it's gonna be something big, then he had this fascination of, ooh, these brands are working also on a psychological level. So he got into more through that to the neuroscience part. And since a couple of years ago, he's really into the brands and the neuroscience. And nowadays he's conducting a research about trusting and sustainability. And welcome on the show. So that was in a nutshell what I could.
It's a nice introduction. So, yeah. But those papers, they had an impact. Yeah. Because they were in those days you had glass milk bottles.
Yeah.
Sometimes you still find them in England, and they have like curb shapes like this.
Yeah.
So when you fold them, they go like this on the bottle.
Yeah.
So, and it was just a whole package with the strap. And before I was just drawing, you know, like ships or whatever. Books full of drawings, but this was the first time that I saw there was a message in design. So that was for me an important thing. So what's the function of design? Is that being beautiful, or does it have a function to influence you, your behavior?
Yeah.
Drink more milk, or
yeah.
Choose this brand of milk of this category. So, and I for me they were like banknotes.
Yeah, well,
this is not what you couldn't find on the internet. But you know, when you have a pile like this, for me it was valuable.
Yeah.
So that was for me that I grasped the notion that design can be valuable.
Yeah.
As a kid, that's something you cannot imagine, but for when you're an adult and you have a pile of money, then you know what's value.
Yeah.
Well, you think that it's value. Of course, it's not. It's only trust. Yeah?
Yeah.
If everyone in the world has trust in money, then the money is valuable, right?
Yeah.
If everyone loses his trust tomorrow, then it's just a pile of paper, right?
Yeah. So it's an agreement system. We agreed upon.
But for me, that pile of paper, what was junk, because it was laying on the side of the road, but for me it was very valuable.
Yeah.
So I thought, what's happening, you know? It's for me an interesting moment.
Yeah. So you just picked them up and...
And treasured them.
Yeah.
I brought them home.
Yeah.
And I looked every one of them, and they were all the same, of course.
Nice. And it was already, because it's a very nice moment that which actually includes all aspects of your interest, because trash, you know, industrial stuff, which is... a design element, packaging, was in nature, you know, and you are also fascinated about nature and sustainability, and it was, you know, kind of epic moment when all aspects were together, like the nature. Oh, this trash was in the nature, maybe it's not the right place. Oh, what can we do? Maybe we should formulate these brands. But I guess it took decades to put this big picture more together.
Well, yeah, you know, the modern brand management is only developed in the late 90s. So when I was 13, there was no brand management. But actually, the packaging in those times, in the 80s, late 70s, begin 80s, actually it was very sustainable. Because it was glass bottles, so you can just clean them. And so you didn't have to recycle. Sometimes they have a lifespan of 2 years. So they will be washed and refilled. And it's only the paper which you can put off. So you can throw it away, not like in the garbage can, but recycled paper. So actually, in those days, we were much more sustainable in packaging than right now, because you have a plastic bottle. That's for me horrible.
I'm killing myself because I use it for months now.
No, that's okay, because the germs inside the bottle, they won't. If you just clean it every day, that you can use it 3 years.
So it's very difficult, as we see, to be all aspects of our life to be always conscious about, oh, is it sustainable enough? Because sometimes you just need some water, but they sell it in bottles, plastic bottles.
I have here a bottle, and this is, of course, marketing. It's a Doppler, well known in the Netherlands, very popular. Of course, you can. This is okay, because in my lectures I use this as an example, because this is about brand personality. So here you have a bottle, for an example, this is a branded bottle, so okay, but maybe you have another bottle with no brand. Then for a no brand bottle you pay about 20 cents, water is free, you know.
Or very cheap.
Well, 0.02, whatever, it doesn't matter. So for the brandless packaging you only pay for distribution and production costs. This is probably 150, I don't know. So you pay for the branding. That's virtual equity, because it's not existing. I mean, you cannot hold it, right? It's like the pile of paper. So people are willing to pay for the trust in their brain, because that's what it is. Brand equity is actually mental equity. It's that we all trust that pile of paper. You trust this brand, or maybe you found this, or you got it for your partner, I don't know. And here, this is 14.50. It's a ludicrous amount of money, right? For a bottle. And you have to refill it yourself. That's the fun part, okay? So you give something.
And the other fun part is that their main interest is also to sell more from that, and this is also plastic.
they say that it's from research, but it's not completely true, but that's okay. But it's about awareness. This is an awareness product, this is a brand product. But of course, this is also a brand. So, but this is about brand personality. This bottle adds more to my personality as my identity, because now I can show everyone, hey, look, I have this bottle, you have this bottle. who you think was better, right? Probably I'm a better person. So that's the whole marketing trick about this. But this is about neurology, because this is how branding works.
Actually, what I'm curious about, what these brands which are having these brand equity, but basically selling very cheap products, if we see the sourcing price, for example, water like this, what do they do with this huge amount of money, what they cash in? Do they have, I mean, it's just a open question, because that's the biggest question. Like, if they have these, if they build this trust and they build this brand equity, that and they sell stuff on 10 or 20 times more price, then it would be also nice to know where that money goes. And
well, for some companies like NGOs and or the meaning economy is also called, it's about that you're a social company, the B Corps for instance, they don't, that it's not their main purpose to make money, it's to make a feasible organization. That because you need money, but you fulfill needs but also make the world a better place. It's a little bit cliche, but that's their main goal. But you also have economical fishing companies, and of course they need a healthy profit. And you know the triangle, you know, people pay it, profit of prosperity, sometimes it changes. I think that a good organization, sustainable branding, is incorporating all these aspects. So there's a social company that takes care of their employees in the whole chain, so not like that people are killed in Bangladesh, and that only the stakeholders get all the money. I mean, I just read today that Bezos, you know, from Amazon, the chief, he got $150 billion. He's now the richest man in the world, and he's going for another $100 billion. For me, that's a crazy idea. He's not giving away any penny. So I don't know what his end goal is. But what you see is that only 1% of the world is earning 80% of all the equity. Sometimes, and this is called the vicious loop. So let me explain this. If you are very, very rich, you can start a bank.
Yeah.
You know that all the banks right now, they are making money, virtual money. So when you get a loan from a bank, when you build a house, it's not like we take off something of this pile of money and give it to you. No, they create money.
Good.
Yeah. But if you are very rich, you start your own bank. So now here's the loop. You are very rich. Like the guy from Alibaba, you know?
Mm-hmm.
He's starting with AliExpress, his own bank. He's making virtual money. And it goes to him. And he goes to his own bank. So you get this loop.
So in the end, it's not about the money, but about the control or influence.
We are the machines, the assets to make him rich.
Yeah.
I think it's a very weird way of looking to our economy. And that's what I want to change. That's one of my missions.
Yeah.
Stop these vicious loops.
Yeah, and I think this brand awareness also from the company side, because in many companies there are many people working, and also for the customer's side, it's very important to see and to know more what these brands are meaning. Why do we have emotional engagement with some of the brands, positive or negative, and people are not aware of this most of the time. And you also mentioned in one of your I don't know if it was an interview or a speech, the good hormones, the dopamine, endorphin, serotonin, and oxytocin, right? That most of the companies, what we see now with these short-term happiness thing, they are focusing on the dopamine. And you suggested that they should also shift their focus and trigger with their branding and with their products more the serotonin, right?
Yeah,
and the oxytocin, because that's the more fulfillment and more safety net. In short, it would mean that it would reduce consumerism in the crazy speed of consumerism and put on the long term much stronger brands, but the short term wins would be nothing.
Well, it's good to have pleasure, you know.
Yeah.
It's a short moment. So you buy a bottle of beer and you're sitting with friends and having a good time. That's short term. But you have always an effect on that on the long term.
Yeah. So it's a drop after
a bottle. If you drink a bottle and you throw it away, then you have pleasure at the short term, but then the long lasting effect, of course, is all the plastic in the forest and in the sea.
So you have to
incorporate with pleasure also the long term effects. So and then it's about cooperation. So I buy these products, but by buying this product, the organization will do this and this and this, and I can contribute on that by doing this and this and this. And then it's another way of consumerism, because you cannot end consumerism, because you have to eat and then buy products.
Just the pace is sometimes is, for example, if you buy sugary drinks, you never get fulfilled. You just you stay thirsty.
Yeah, so well, but this is all the pre-processed, processed foods. I hate processed food, because you don't have any control anymore on how it's made. So if you buy a ready-made, well, that's your own choice. But I just,
it's trust again. You have
to
trust.
But this is branding. Yeah. It's not actually trust because people actually don't know what's in it.
Mm.
If you buy a package to make a meal, and it's only cheese and additives, then you just buy a package of sauce, but it's dry, you know.
Mm.
But it's only potato meal what's in it, mostly.
Yeah.
So, and then it's salt and sugar.
Yeah.
And
but then can you talk about trust in the branding or in the brand?
Yeah.
Like people assume that they can trust in certain brands, so they buy all the time the same, even if it's fast food.
Well, you know, if you buy an honest product and you can see what it is, then the product is the product is the promise. So you can see that here in this model. And this is the first thing what you see when you're in the supermarket. It is, okay, well, what's the benefit for me when I buy this? If you have time, most people don't have time, but then you can find some information about the company itself. So its origin, its purpose, what are their concerns, if they have a lot of resources needed, but there's only a few left in the world, then they should change their strategy. If they don't, it's short-term policy, so you shouldn't buy the product anyway. But so, and here is where the trust actually starts, but it's not full trust because it's not social. So what you do is with these products, it's like this bottle again, I just use it because I have it here, but what you do is you show it to your friends, right? So, okay, first you check, is it a good product? Okay, is it durable? Is it long-lasting, whatever, how it's made? And then I'm showing you it to you, and you say, oh yeah, you have a top of one, I've only that one.
Mine is broken, by the way, it fell
no,
down.
No, you don't have to apologize. This is great advertising in the way that you do it, because now you want to join in. This is social proof. This is exactly what happens, okay? So, if you say no, it's a horrible product, the trust stops immediately.
Mm.
So sometimes you have great brands with great products, but if the common people don't like the product, even if it's the best product in the world, there are a lot of product failures because the people didn't get it.
Mm.
They didn't like it on what way. And then here, this is the bonding part. Now it's becoming very important, because if you walk with this bottle, it's part of my identity.
Yeah, it's a status.
Yeah, social status, yeah, but it's part of me now.
Yeah.
It's not like now it's a product, right?
Mm.
But if I'm wearing it and I'm showing that you have it, and I'm a great person, now it's the brand personality becoming my personality.
Mm.
So now it's very important that you have a brand fit, so that the values of the organizations match my values.
Mm.
And if here is a misfit, not a brand fit, then you lose trust also.
Yeah.
So, and this is the loop which you can always make with branding. If you build a sustainable, strong brand, first you have to look at your own company. It's inside, internal branding it's called. So what are your values? What are your purpose, vision, mission? So what kind of message and which product are you sending into the world? Is the product in that sustainable? Is it good? You know, is it durable? Is it payable? And then, if you buy it, you're talking with other people. So this is part of the partaking. So, so you don't have actually a bonding, let's say for coffee beans. You
know?
But for Starbucks, you have a bonding. A lot of people go into Starbucks not for the beans. They say it's great coffee, but that's not. No, because the values of the Starbucks matches with their own values. They want to be an urban citizen or whatever, an urban dweller and cool or whatever. They don't like it if you say it like this, but that's of course what happens.
Yeah, if you build it down there on your layers of their behavior, it's like they want to belong to somewhere.
Yeah, but that makes them vulnerable.
They want to be cool.
Yeah. But because if you strip everyone naked, then everyone is the same, right?
Yeah.
So we're all learning the monkeys too, that's what I always say.
Nice. And just to go back to, so from 13 on you were fascinated in this topic, and then you studied design, but already with the purpose that you wanna do some some
no
responsible.
Well, I had an airbrush at home, and I painted the posters.
Yeah.
With environmental messages, but it was, I mean, it was very niche in those times. You had Greenpeace, you know, and people with dreadlocks, and it was outside the community, let's say, outside society.
Yeah.
So it was like very
subculture.
It was it was a subculture, and it was very hard to fit in because if you are young, you want to fit in, right? Mm. So I was wearing the brands that my friends also wearing, right?
Yeah.
So but I was making drawings, and I had it wrong when I was 10 or 11, which I had already designed houses with sun ceilings.
Solar panels,
and windmills, but there were no solar panels and there were no windmills already available there in those times. Yeah. But now I have a home and now I have solar panels.
Cool.
Yeah, our new office is completely sustainable with recycled plastic.
Nice.
Yeah. So most people think that, like for example, the tiny housing movement, they say, you have to build them with wood, you know. But this is plastic that's already, you the only way which you can use it, you can reuse it or you can burn it.
Mm.
Our whole complete new building is built of the side stream of those plastics.
Wow.
So I think it's more sustainable than,
it's
the most sustainable you can build. But people don't like it because they say plastic.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. Otherwise it would be burned, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
so it's very sustainable. It goes longer than wood.
Yeah.
So
I'm not into it, but it's interesting to look it up.
Yeah.
So the whole building, the walls and everything,
it's from plastic. Yeah.
Okay. And most of the buildings will be demolished at some point, and that will be also.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fully recyclable.
Okay.
So you can strip all the plastic off. Yeah.
Like Lego.
It's like, of course. Not exactly, but you can strip the whole outside of the building, and you can reuse it again. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, but that's a choice, you know.
Mm. So you had all the time from the from you were 13 up till college. This fascination with nature and combine it with the design, or
well, the design first, of course.
Yeah.
I mean,
and then you wanted to engage with these subculture groups who were more eco-friendly.
Yeah, but I wrote my thesis on the academy about eco design.
Yeah.
So, but it was not the right time.
Yeah.
Because it was easy to say, I hate Shell, because that's not new, right? For over 30 years, people hate Shell. That's not new, you know? But you have to offer a solution. If you only say no, it's negative. People cannot engage with this kind of message. You say, fuck that, okay. Sorry with the language, but it doesn't help. So what I want to do is contribute to sustainable brand trust that people are choosing with a good feeling for the right products. Which is also cool, by the way. That's the most important, because this is the most important part on everything else. You can be, what I said, you can build fantastic products, but if they are not cool, and they don't add up with social proof, so you cannot engage with the product. And
That's why, for example, Tesla is also getting very popular.
Yeah, but
I'm not sure it's
losing too much of money. And I think that they're losing the game. It was a starter, you know. It was a fire starter. He put electric cars on the map, but now BMW, Opel, all the huge brands, also China, they will bring en masse electric cars.
But that was the purpose of Tesla.
But he burned a lot of money. So, and he could do other things, because his point was made. His point now is already made, and he's now half a billion loss. Okay. Nice, Mr. Musk, you have made your point.
Mm.
Point proven, okay, now do something wisely with all this kind of money. Instead of being an ego, because he has a huge ego, which is fine with me, by the way.
Yeah.
Sometimes you need egos, so that's okay. But now I think he's, because he, even his new model, it isn't going to make it.
Mm.
Because within 2 or 3 years, when it's really coming into market, it's too late. His first advantage, the first advantage move that you can have, he had that moment and he lost it.
Yeah.
So,
but,
yeah.
I mean, I'm empathic about Tesla, also because of Nikola Tesla. He was the biggest inventor, and the name is coming from his name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But what I'm happy about Tesla, and I don't care if it will be bankrupt or not, that they kind of demolished this 100-year-old myth of that the electric cars are not a way to go. Because there were already electric cars in the early 1900s.
Yeah, but you cannot compare with the cars right now.
But if we see there was a documentary, Who Killed the Electric Car? There was from General Motors made an electric car in the 90s, which had a range of I think 90 miles, which is a kind of enough for urban dwellers, and it was also cheap, very good,
yeah,
very
okay.
popular.
Here you go again. It's a very good product,
but it was not cool.
It was not its time, you know. You need momentum.
People loved this, so there was a big movement to keep the car, but the industry was so strong on the oil base that they bought back all of the cars and demolished, just to don't even have any memories about the car.
Yeah,
it's a fascinating movie.
Yeah.
People who killed the electric car.
Yeah, it's a nice one. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's the same for Kodak with the first digital camera.
Yeah.
They were the first, but there was no market for it.
Actually, they invented that,
and then they
were not conscious about that they have a new technology, and they were still pushing.
No, but sometimes it takes time to see what you've made.
Yeah.
When I did my first privacy research on the internet and with Garbage Park, it was in the 90s. People didn't get it.
Yeah.
I warned them about privacy. What? Privacy? Because I'm anonymous, right? And now we're 25 years later, and it's still a huge problem. So, actually, my whole research now is about privacy and first.
Wow.
So, yeah.
So that was a kind of next step after the design school. You were doing also design, but it was digital design for the interface, but also this privacy part.
Was yeah, that was
in
my master's.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because because in 93 we had internet in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
So I was one of the first in the Netherlands that had access to, because I did the master emerging media and computer science. So
yeah.
It was really good. We had the Mosaic browser.
Hmm.
I don't think it says anything to you.
No,
but it was very clumsy in those days. But you could make a very easy web page, and it was all semantic, you know. Yeah, and then I thought, okay, then the first platforms were introduced from the States, and people are sharing information, and it was for me, wow, you know. If I now sit with you, I say, okay, I have a pen and paper, would you give me your pen? Your account number?
Mm-hmm.
No, you have to give me your telephone number. I don't think you would do it, still not now. People also say, what are you doing? Why are you asking that? And online? People try everything online. So this was in the beginning of the 90s.
Wow.
So I built a garbage, it's a digital virtual web park, it's called the Garbage Park, and people could visit the park, and they were visited, and they're leaving traces.
Hmm.
And these traces, I could link back. So if you went to the park, you're a visitor, a profile page was made on your behavior,
hmm.
and everyone could look at your profile.
Wow.
Yeah, people didn't like that, right?
Hmm.
Now it's the fun part. If I knew that you were there and you knew that I was there, we could look each other's profile, right? That's interesting, because we are that's the whole success of Facebook.
Yeah,
you can
peek
around at someone's profile.
Yeah.
So what I did is, if you looked at my profile, an email was sent to me that you were looking at my profile.
Yeah.
And if I was looking at your profile, you received an email that I was looking at your profile. People were pissed off. What were you doing?
Yeah.
People were confronted with reality and they didn't like it.
Yeah.
So what I did, I had to shut it down in 2 weeks because people were too pissed off. So instead of doing something with this awareness, you say, no, it doesn't exist.
Yeah. don't worry about that.
Yeah, and you see the problems, no?
Yeah. And it's strange, like you were into design and you were using computers to softwares to make design, and then you shifted to this interface and new media because of that. I'm just trying to find the link there.
Yeah, well, when I finished my master's, I went. I started a design company.
Yeah.
So, because you have to make money, right?
Yeah.
And being an artist, especially in digital art, it's impossible. Because if you made a website, you know, for painting, people will pay money.
Yeah.
But they've said, here, have a floppy disk. That was in those times.
Yeah.
A floppy disk with a beautiful design website. What?
Yeah. Well,
I don't have a computer or... I don't have internet, so yeah. So it was very conceptual, you know. We had discussions in those times about virtual bodies, way ahead into the future. And I invented neuroface, the term neuroface. It's about brain neural interfacing with computer systems.
Oh.
But that was too far away, and still now. But yeah, but now I'm giving keynotes. Yeah. About this future, because now you can buy these technology. It's already into the market, so you can. It's called deep invasive brain interfacing, and so you can build these. You can buy these devices for your own purpose.
Okay.
Yeah, to keep you sharp, for example. This is what people don't like if I tell this, but
yeah. So this brain wave.
No, it's not the EEG cap. That's what you can use. Yeah. That's outside the skull, right?
Yeah.
So it's about cranial activity, just on the screen, the skull. But this goes deeper.
Okay.
So you can put stuff right on the motor cortex.
Hmm.
But you can even go deeper into the insula and the septum area, and that's all terms. But that's where your pleasure center are.
Yeah, but how do you put them on?
No, they drill a hole into the skull and they put them in.
So it's not for home users?
Well, I think that within 10, 15 years, people... Because, you know, when you're a banker, you can do things. You can drink a lot of coffee, or you can sniff coke or whatever. Yeah. But all those drugs, the endocrine opiates are already in your brain.
Yeah.
So if you can stimulate these opiates within without having using to use drugs, it's more effective, right?
So you are talking about maybe soon implantations that they're gonna put some like a kind of pacemaker like thing in the brain, and then when it's like stress situation,
and you push the button.
So it's
not science fiction anymore.
Yeah.
But that's one side path. But go back to the. To the design age, yeah. So I work for a lot of brands.
Mm.
Did packaging design, identity design.
And then when I also read that when Apple started to become big, then you got much more aware of like this brand stuff is really what you have to put your focus on.
Yeah,
was
because
it inspired by Apple?
No, it was not actually by Apple, but I wrote a paper, and it was also in the 90s, about virtual branding.
Hmm.
So you have to imagine that in those days, every brand had a physical product.
Hmm. Yeah.
But of course, we were at the beginning of internet, and of course, there were brands, companies, only doing stuff online. You had Second Life. Do you know that?
I've heard about that.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Yeah, that's now Fortnite or whatever, all these games. And multiplayer games where you can form teams online. But Second Life was like a virtual reality environment. And you could step into that world. And so there were people selling stuff in that virtual world, can you imagine? So only virtual stuff. So they make stuff in this virtual world and they're selling this virtual stuff to virtual people.
Mm.
Yeah. So... the first virtual brands were born.
Mm-hmm.
So I wrote a paper about that because I thought this is interesting because the world is becoming virtual. If it's not now, then 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. And now you see that the most valuable brands in the world are virtual brands.
Yeah.
Can you pick up Amazon?
No.
Yeah, the box, if they deliver, but it's not Amazon itself. Can you pick up Facebook?
Yeah, or Airbnb.
Yeah. So. But you see, and I wrote about it in the 90s, and all those people were looking at me, nice here. Yeah, so.
Wow.
Yeah.
And how was it a bit, I mean, you had a strong, educated guess that is gonna happen?
It's predicting the future, you but you never know.
Yeah.
No, but if you extrapolate.
Yeah.
You know, and the more you go into the future, the blurry it becomes, of course.
Yeah.
Because people don't know how, of course, we don't know how the future will look like.
Yeah.
But if you invent something, you can say, okay, this will be probably the next model. This will probably be the next model. When the first mobile phone was developed, it was a shitty thing like this, very expensive. Of course, you could imagine that it would become smaller. And it became so small that it was too small.
Yeah.
And then
they are growing again. Yeah,
because I have this is the iPhone X. And actually, if you look at the G3 was like this, so it's much more smaller, but it was too small.
Yeah.
People like bigger screens.
Yeah.
And now the tablet is gone. So first the desktop computers disappeared. I mean, most people have a laptop, right?
Mm.
Only in offices they still use, or when you have a very fast game console, whatever.
Yeah.
But the whole tablets, I think it's only a few percent still left on the tablet market, because everyone is or using the laptop or the growing mobile phones.
Mm.
So that's, and no one could predict that. Because when the iPad came, this will be the future. Everyone will be walking around with an iPad. Well, you don't walk around with an iPad, right? or another tablet. So you see, it's very hard to predict the future. But what you can see is human behavior.
Mm.
I mean, my core is social neuroscience. And of course, that's behavior related. So, I mean, we still have 10 fingers, right? Two eyes, ears.
Yeah.
So that's not going to change. Maybe we can increase our sensory information input by senses. So let's say you have a virtual world, and now you're wearing goggles. Probably it will be lenses in a couple of years, in built-in, not piece of plastics. It's with cochlear implants, they're already on the market, so that's not new.
Yeah.
So actually you don't see anything anymore. You have deep invasive brain interfaces. So actually we can shuffle around with virtual reality within your brain.
I don't know if it's
no, but that will. So if you talk about predicting the future, that's my prediction. That will happen. Yeah, I think that neural interfacing or neurofacing will be will be common in 30 years. Yeah, for people that can afford it, of course.
Yeah.
And this is a very old discussion about the haves and the have not.
Yeah.
There are people now that are left out. They cannot build houses, buy houses anymore at places where you can make a lot of money, like San Francisco, or Alto Hotel or whatever. Not everyone can afford computer technology. But if you want a job, I think within 20-25 years, people are saying, okay, you want a job? I want you to have this implant and this implant so we can communicate on this level with you.
Well.
And if you say no, say, who cares? Then we have 10 others who are willing to buy these implants.
Interesting. Yeah. So we have to trust also on those implantation companies and.
Well, that's the biggest fear. I mean, you can hack a computer.
Yeah.
This is my biggest warning in my lectures. In the future, people can hack your brain.
Yeah.
And then you don't know what's real or more. Listen, if I put something in your computer, like a folder with information, probably you will know, hey, this is not my folder, right? Because you have a distinction from your own brain and the other devices where you're surrounded with, like your mobile phone.
Yeah.
If I put a memory trace in your brain, you cannot exist, you cannot make the distinction anymore if it's from yourself or not. You're going to doubt yourself. And then this is gone.
And actually, this is also happening already nowadays with content. Also, like back in the history, we always say that the winners write the history, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then these days, they call it psyops, like psychological operations, when some interest groups, or media companies, they make enormous amount of content in a topic from one specific angle, and they can demonize people or glorify other people, And yeah, and all of these are tracing back to those little the hormones, what we release if we see them or if we hear about them. It's
It's very hard to control these mechanisms.
Yeah, and I think your mission is, in that sense, is very important to spread this message and to get to more and more people. And this social neuroscience sounds very interesting, but I also cannot imagine how do you do the measurements, because for me neuroscience seems like, okay, there are hormones, there are brain waves, so you measure them, you put them stuff in the people and sensors, and you measure.
Well, that's one way. So you can look at that one neurobiology, so, but this is very on a very basic level.
Yeah.
So when you're using EEG to measure electrical activity just under the skull, it's just, you know what's happening because you see the signal, and you know what's happening when people see it, some stimuli, you know. But it's very hard to go to a level further.
So that's the question.
And when you use fMRI, that's all the scanning stuff, you see some blobs on the screen, and of course you know from this is this area, this is this area, but there's always a measurement after stimuli. So if you have an image, people look at it, and you see, for example, the amygdala lighting up, or the nucleus accumbens or whatever.
Yeah.
Then it's okay, people like this image, or they hate it, or they fear it. Yeah. So this kind of thing, but it's very on a basic level. It's very hard. And what I do is I let people make decisions as quickly as possible. So so your brain is not your brain. Your brain is part of your body, right?
Yeah.
So your hormones, neurotransmitters are only in the brain. Hormones are the messengers through all the body. So actually, you can do very good measurements by using your hands.
Mm.
It's still neuroscience.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's what I do. I made devices. It's called World Brain Wave. It's a platform. And what I do is I try to map the neural pathways that people have on specific topics.
Yeah, based on their reaction.
Yeah. The faster the reaction, the stronger the neural connections.
Mm.
So for fear, people are very primed very fastly on fear.
Mm.
So, and the fastest way is a reflex, and a reflex is actually from outside your consciousness. So you're jumping away, and you don't know why you jumped. Oh.
Mm.
That's post-stress neuralization, so you have time, and all the information goes to the visual cortex, and then you have time to calculate what you have seen. Yeah, but that's so deep, but you cannot reflect on that. So if you jump away, you have a reflective movement.
Mm.
It's very hard to say in that moment what did you experience. Actually, you did experience nothing because it went too fast.
Yeah, because they also say that there is also muscle memory, so maybe you just reacted without any...
And actually, at that moment, you don't have an emotional response.
Mm.
People think that emotions are the trigger to that kind of behavior.
Mm.
But at a reflex speed, it's just the other way around.
It's more instinctual.
And you jump away, and then your brain signals you as a warning that you jumped away.
Yeah.
It's the other way around.
Wow.
Yeah. So,
Fascinating topic. And now you are conducting this research, or your main research topic is trust in sustainability.
Well, I'm researching trust, how trust works in the brain.
Okay.
Because I think
the niche what you are working on, sustainability.
No, if that's when I started in trusting sustainability, now trusting trust, the first thing what I missed in the literature and the research was, what is trust? So there's a lot of written in trust, but it's about the effects of trust. So trust in economy, trust in social behavior. And when you have a psychology book, about 300 pages, you will find two alineas about trust, and then it stops. And it's mostly about face recognition, you know? You have a very angry person, and you have a smiling person.
Mm.
And that's the only research they did, and that's what you will find in a psychology book. So I had to start all over again. So if I want to researching trust and trusting sustainability. Yeah, first I have to research trust. So that's, and I will be the, for the coming 25 years, that will be my topic, because I'm only, there are only a few people in the world that are interested in this field, because it's very hard to build a career in science on this topic, because it's so complex.
I don't know if it's directly related, but I read a book about sharing economies or something like that from a New York professor, Arun Sundararajan. And he's also one of the core of this thing was his research was the trust. For example, Airbnb or all of these companies, what they represent with their brand is the trust.
Yeah, but that's also an effect of trust.
Yeah.
So it's very easy to describe an effect of trust. So let's say you trust me at the moment, I presume, because I don't give you cue signals that I'm dangerous. So that's an effect of trust, right? But for me it's interesting what's happening on a deeper level, on a neurochemical level in the brain. So, but and the neural pathways. So the reaction times.
It's like jumping out without conditions. Because I remember that you were also discussing with someone trust and transparency, and trust is without control. You give the control to that person or brand, right? And you and in transparency, if we see the transparency, you want the control, you want to have the overview. So in that sense, somehow trust is when you don't want control, you believe, or
you have different forms of trust. So for cognitive trust, so when you make a calculation, you want transparency. So when you build a bridge and you buy wood, then you want to know what kind of wood. And when the supplier says, trust me, I give you some wood, but I'm not going to tell you what kind of wood, how could you build the bridge? That's impossible, right? So that it's like bank. Okay. I give you my money, what's going to happen with my money? Then the bank has to be transparent, otherwise you don't trust the bank. So for cognitive trust, when you make calculations, it's also making predictions into the future. So when you want to save something and the bank promises you 5% the deposit rent, then you know what you will have in the end. But when the bank is changing the rules in between, you don't trust the bank anymore, right? So this is about transparent. So, and a lot of companies has to be transparent right now, because we just want to know what they are doing.
And you think they we want to know, we became aware because of this distrust has been developed in the last maybe 5 to 10 years, since we know more how they operate, or we can look it up in the internet, what are the ingredients, how those ingredients are influencing us, when they just, wait a minute, we were eating your food or having your products for 10 years and you have this poisonous thing.
So what all those banks or whatever, they have to be transparent in this loop.
And actually it's a very, it would be a health, very healthy model for humanity.
I hope so.
I want to go a little bit into this sustainable trust in sustainability, because you know often we just don't, I mean, we want to believe in sustainability, we want to make the choices, but since the internet spread and we can look it up and there are these scandals and many different information, it's a very relevant topic to think about, if we trust or if we don't trust in companies, if how sustainable are they? How do you see that? Is it a very difficult question for a company to be sustainable and trustworthy? Or
well, first, you know, you have companies that are started. They started sustainable, so they don't have a legacy, which was maybe not so clean. Okay. And it's not fair to say those companies that have a longer existence say, you do everything wrong and we start the right way. Because it's easy, right?
Yeah.
So it's like you play golf your whole life, I have a stupid example, and I started with tennis. And of course, I started with tennis, so I'm better at tennis. And I said, hey, you're not a good sport.
Yeah.
A good sportsman because you started with golf. It's a stupid comparison. Yeah. So, but people, the companies have to change.
Yeah.
In the end, all the companies will be sustainable because that's the only business model that will thrive in the future. So it's not choice, because if you don't use your resources right, then you end up at some point that your resources are gone.
Mm.
We have some metals. They are only for 5 to 10 years on this planet and then they're gone.
Mm.
And we need them for mobile technology.
Mm.
So you cannot sell mobile phones anymore. So you have a problem, right?
Yeah.
So the whole supply chain has to be sustainable.
Yeah.
And what you now see is that some ingredients of the devices are becoming very valuable. So there's a new business model. People are getting all those old devices and they are collecting these metals again. So you see that this is changing.
Yeah, I think it's much more the platform based business model to create these circular elements.
Yeah, well, that will be the next point is that you don't buy stuff anymore, but you rent solution.
I'm also kind of suspicious about that, because if you can just rent. Then someone will still own that platform.
It depends on the product. Let's say clothing, I don't see it happening with clothing.
Yeah.
But lighting in buildings, cars, you know? When you buy a car, it's a very expensive car, then you want to own it. That's the whole concept of owning. Your brain is very strongly wired on owning something.
Yes.
Because it feels like a pain when I take it from you. That's why people hate it when you pick them their mobile phones.
Yeah.
Because your brain is very attached to the, because it's behavioral. Huh? You're using the holding it in your hand and you tingling by your, all your attention, brain activity goes into this machine. So when I take it off you, your brain is really confused.
Yeah.
Oh, there goes my super toy, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But when it's just commodity, I mean, let's say if you have a packaging, you buy from tomorrow your milk in sustainable packaging. So you're buying the milk and not the packaging. Do you care?
No,
exactly. So you have a lot of business models that you can actually rent the commodity without owning it.
Yeah, I understand that part. I just see also that people have different life patterns. Like sometimes when they are young, they can afford more. And if it's if every element of our life is subscription based, that all we have electricity car, and you know, it's another form of enslavement. So that's why I'm not 100% believer of that.
Hmm.
But also that if we have durable products, what also people can fix or buy the ingredients or the parts to buy it or fix it, then it's another way.
But the problem is you need a mind shift. This has to start the mindset. So if you want to share products, then you have to build communities again.
Yeah.
Then you have to say hello on the street, which we
do
not do anymore. You know, we are living in big cities like strangers. You have a million people, and you have a million strangers. That's crazy. Our brain is not wired like that.
No.
So when you go to your neighbor, we're living in a very small, it's not even a village, it's just 5 houses on the row. We borrow everything, because it's stupid. When I have a drilling machine or whatever, why we should buy 5 of them? Of course not.
There are many holes and copes and this kind of...
But that's a form of community, and we have to relearn that again, like in the old days, you know, in the Middle Ages.
I know, I studied this rural sociology, whatever they come up with, these new sharing economy models in a healthy rural society, you can still see them at the core.
But this is the mind shift. People have to change. It's like electricity or energy. More and more people will go off the grid.
Yeah.
The energy, the huge, large energy companies, they don't like it because they let us rule it. We build a lot of, we throw a lot of windmills into the sea, you know, and it's cheap, always cheap. Stupid idea, because they're ruining all the environment and they don't pay for it. So it's like Shell, you know, it, like gasoline for if you buy an airplane ticket, it should be 3 times as expensive than now, because it's also subsidized.
Yeah,
and it's not in all the agreements. the flying industry is kept out of it.
That's what that was one of the important questions what I wanted to mention, that you said something about price of the products, and for example in food it's the normal thing that, for example, the biological food is always much more expensive, and the cheaper food or the regular food is always cheap, and it's just a perception that it's cheap because all of the hidden costs are not displayed. So I was also wondering that it would be nice to display the real price, because all of the external costs like health, environmental, social costs, they are not paid. So how can we, you know, safely buy stuff? Or
there's a lot of good food, so our brain loves salt, sugar, and fat,
survival.
And it's cheap, that's the problem. The cheapest ingredient. So if you make a product and you want to the kids like it, you throw sugar in.
Yeah.
I mean, we have frozen fruits and so on because our children love to eat yogurt with fruits. Yeah. But it's not possible to buy those frozen food without added sugar.
Mm.
That's stupid. Then I have to go to Eco Plaza, healthy environmental shop, to buy that, and it's three times expensive. But it's strange because it has less ingredients.
Yeah.
Do explain. You know, that's the problem. But it has, of course, to do with production.
Yeah.
Mass production makes products cheap, and if the food companies would make a choice to skip all the unhealthy stuff and only produce en masse the healthy products, then it will become cheaper. But the problem is, this is also the mind shift, it's also a taste shift.
Yeah.
We are addicted to sugar, salt, and fat.
Yeah, we love it. So.
Yeah.
I also had a diet when I was not eating, so I normally never eat sugar, but I haven't eaten salt for a month, and then I felt this, it was a strange feeling, and then I also digged into this hedonic system of the body, we have, and it was also like a nice example. If you would just cook a potato or any kind of stuff without any spices, then you would never overeat yourself.
Yeah.
It's a very, very old addiction what we have to this.
Well, but it tastes good.
That makes life, you know, tasty.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we do. Yeah. You know, our brain is interested in a few things.
Yeah.
Safety, sex, and food. And that's what it is.
Wow.
Yeah, so.
Nice. And there are many, many ways how to protect ourselves.
Well, it depends, because social status, this is very important. So if you eat healthy now, it's becoming a form of social status.
Yeah.
It's not like drinking your frappuccino, blah, 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 at the Starbucks, you know. Yeah. That's why people like Starbucks, because it's in the username's Instagram or whatever, not fine with me.
Yeah.
I think that within 10 years, it's gone.
Yeah.
You know what surprised me? I use sometimes Twitter, you know. All those millions of hours that people spend on social media ruining their lives, because it's a waste of time, you know? People are busy 2-3 hours a day with social media, and for what?
It depends. If someone uses it for professionally, it's
okay. but that's a minimal amount of people. So we want to share, but it's so short. I mean, the timeline is so long that it's only for a few milliseconds that people are scrolling. Oh yeah, that's John. Okay, that's fine. Oh yeah, it's Lisa. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, information is. And now you came up with one other very important topic, is the attention.
Ah, attention. Yeah, our brain loves attention.
Yeah, like for example. Because what you are saying, find what you have already posted on the internet and on your website and many other good stuff on the YouTube and on social media, there is a lot of good thing already there to make these ideas happen. but in marketing they call it noisy. So the online platform is noisy because of other irrelevant, stupid stuff. So that's why we also, or all of those who want to put some valuable content out, they have to kind of compete with all of the other stuff just to be heard. And all of those people who are plugged on the internet, you know, like those hundreds of millions, Twitter, YouTube, they have to have some good content too to balance out that enormous amount of stupidity. Yeah.
And a lot. Which is out there. And it's a rat race. Yeah. So if one brand posts 10, then the other brand will post 20. And then the other brand will post 30. So now it's just one bombardment of million posts a day, which you cannot even see in one day post at the moment, you cannot see your whole lifetime. It makes no sense anymore. It's just noise.
Yeah.
And I stop because I think it's a waste of time. Because you're always too late. It's in the it's not high value information.
Yeah, so that was one of the other questions. How do you protect your life? By knowing this, all of what you know about the brain, your brain and other people's brain, what tips can you maybe share with other people to...
You know, 10 years ago, we believed in curation, you know, that the people are filtering the information on quality, but it didn't help because it's too much.
Yeah.
In the old days, you had a museum, you know, you had a curator and they say, this is fine art, this is rubbish. We don't know.
Yeah, but that was again.
Yeah, but it was the filter, you know? So what you see in different layers in time, you see different filter mechanisms. And now we're totally lost because there is no curation anymore because it's too much. It's too much. Even the newspapers, they are searching only in their bubble. You know, the term echo chamber?
Yeah.
But people read those papers because they like the information. So if they change their opinion, then you wouldn't buy the paper anymore. So it's like a locked in. Everyone is locked in at the moment in their own echo chamber. It's very difficult to break out because then you need a new filter system.
Yeah.
And it's not possible because it's so hard to have your own filter system already running. It's a complete information overload.
And the other question is, if we trust in the curators or the filter system, like who decides what is valuable and what is not valuable?
I have
because
one
it's also very 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 personal.
I have one movie, and maybe you can put it in this while I'm talking right now. Yeah. You can put it in, and it's one guy is on Instagram and he posts, he has 2.5 million followers, and he posts something, and at that moment the reactions are pouring in. And it goes with the speed that goes on and on for minutes. It's from the human measurement, it's impossible to react anymore.
Yeah.
So, and that's what's happening right now, and it's coming into a collision. I think that the whole new media, social media, and all those systems that we developed, they will come to a standstill within 5 to 10 years. Because people are fed up with it. I already see a new generation. I see it with my children. They're 8 and 10. They're totally not interested anymore. They say, what stupid stuff is this? Why waste my time? They have so much awareness now because they didn't see the growth of it. We are a generation. Yeah. We see it developed.
Mm.
Yeah? So it's like it's not true, but the boiling frog story, you know? It's not true. The frog always jumped out, but when you heat up the water, then it stays in. We are in the middle of the boiling soup at the moment, and but we will jump out. There will be a time when everyone stops using it. Yeah. And then what you will see is a huge. That's a real mind shift. And this is a prediction. I don't know. Maybe I'm totally wrong.
Yeah.
But I don't care. That the biggest value brands at the moment are the virtual value brands. Will all go better.
I know.
Yeah. They seem to be predictions. So.
Yeah, they seem to be very powerful nowadays. Yeah, I'm also. It's scary to see how people plugged in 24/7 or on one hand, again, there is no black and white. There is also good information, also bad information. There are many useful.
Yeah, but for me, this is old fashioned. I have here. This is the iPhone X. I think this is the last one I will buy, because, or I totally quit with it, or I think that, you know, 50 years ago, then you had a telephone that was on the hallway.
Yeah.
And you had to walk 20 meters.
Yeah.
Yeah? And then in the 70s, they moved into the living room, and it was only 10 meters. Yeah?
Yeah.
And then they moved up into the bedroom.
Yeah.
You know, maybe your parents had a telephone in the bedroom. It's only 1 meter, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now it's only centimeters. Do you think it stops here? A stupid idea. Of course not. It will go into your brain. People don't like it, but 10, 15 years ago, no one was addicted to this thing. No one was carrying it 24/7. So, yeah, we already attached.
In the beginning, you said that we're gonna have all of these implantations and sensors and stuff.
If you can afford them. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, but they won't be connected to some database like Google or YouTube.
No, they will. But that's the new frontier, and it will be artificial intelligence.
Mm.
So let's say you in the near future you will have an personal assistant, virtual assistant, agent, whatever name you can call it right now, because there's no common sense of what will be the name, and that's your agent. Well, I prefer to call it a virtual agent, and that agent is a reflection of your because it has a connection with your brain, so it knows what you're, not that it can mind read, because that's still science fiction, but it can measure what you like. So if you eat something and you have a lot of dopamine and insula, the septum, then he knows, okay, you like this food, right?
So they are good in pattern recognition.
Yeah, and of course, and it will create patterns, new patterns for you. These agents will make decisions for you within the virtual world. And when you think of something you need, you need to know something, and the virtual agent will help you. It's like now there's assistants already, which you can buy from Android and from Apple C, for example. But that will much more integrated. So you have always like an encyclopedia or whatever. But you can also give it orders. Three days I want to go on holiday, I want to do this and this and this. And the virtual assistant makes all the appointments. And just at the right time you will hear, because you have a cognitive implant, you will say, okay, within 10 minutes you have to walk this aisle when you're on the airport, and it will already make you. Yeah. But this is not science fiction.
At the same time, we are also addicted to data. We always want to learn, we want to know, oh, there is no internet. Oh, the internet is slower than yesterday.
But at the moment we are the best documented generation ever in human history, right? So much information that humans cannot make patterns anymore in this information, but the artificial intelligence systems in the future can do that. But they will see it's a lot of rubbish. We think we are important, but we're not. We just ants on the planet. So that's for me the mind shift that we have. We have only one planet. It's stupid that we think that we are important and destroying our home planet at the same time.
Yeah.
It makes no sense for me.
That was a nice end. It was just so beautiful.
All right, then. You cut it over there.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are, I don't know what to say, but let's say hi to the people. Bye-bye, people.
See you.
See you. And be careful with your hormones and neurotransmitters, and try to step back and see how you can influence yourself.
Be nice.
Be nice.
Always be nice in everything you do.
Cool.
Okay.
So.